Awesome. Okay, so before I start the presentation, I have taken some of the pictures from social media as well as OBI and other places as well. So I would like to thank all the photographers who have contributed their photographs for this particular presentation. Start with presentation is something. Fly catchers, what we should know is what exactly are the fly catchers. So, for example, most of the fly catchers belong to this family called as Muscicapidae, and these are the classic examples of this family. Like, for example, they can be brown. Kind of birds, because some of them be really bright, some of them like Niltawas are like extremely bright shining birds, some of them are highly endemic to certain parts of the country. And when you look at Muscicapidae family where flycatchers really belong, we should also other birds in Muscicapidae which are not really flycatchers, pigeons or short wings, bush beaters, bush robins, all these birds come under Muscicapidae as a family. But when we go and look into more details, what we are familiar with as a flycatchers, like for example, fantails or even a paradise flycatcher or even fantail, those don't really belong to this family. So what we should look out right now is like these. Can we say they are not truly the flycatchers? Probably. But let's go and see how these flycatchers are, where these flycatchers are, and if there is any way to figure out some of these difficult to identify flycatchers to make them get some clues to identify how to see them easily or where to expect them. So where does one find flycatchers in India? So when we look at India, and flycatchers are all over the place. All the way from Himalayas to southernmost tip of India to Andaman Nicobars to dry arid areas of Rajasthan, Gujarat to dense evergreen forest of Northeast. So they're distributed all over the place. There is no place in India which I can think of where either the bird is not present at all or at least is present in certain time of the year. So when you come to their behavior, some of the flycatchers are really bold. You can actually see them very easily. Some of them can be really inconspicuous, very shy. Usually they are on their own or during breeding season, then they can be in pairs, but they do participate in mixed hunting flocks as well and very actively as well. And as that mainly happens in non-breeding season, because breeding season these birds are on their territories. And almost all these flycatchers show altitudinal migration. And their long distance migration as well. Like some of the flycatchers which breed in Siberia can all the way winter all the way in southernmost India. And most of the Himalayan flycatchers, even if they are not flying to southern peninsula in India, but at the same time they're just moving up and down this mountain elevation. So because of that, before we get to that particular aspect, of course, flycatchers do like to go after insects. They try and catch them in the air. Okay. So most of these flycatchers try and find insects on the wings. And certain species even try and pick out insects from the ground as well, or even branches. But most of the, as the name suggests, they are trying to catch insects on the air. And before we go into further more details, like for example, because they want to catch these insects, their bills are also more or less flattened. So that's what helps them catch insects much better. And as they fly long distances, they move up and down in elevation, they do have a really long primary projections, which actually helps them fly long distances, and which primary projection also helps us out in certain species. How to differentiate them between to tell one from the other. And this is what happens when the plumages, because that's something which we need to figure out. But thankfully, in flycatchers, like this is the example of a Nilgiri flycatcher, where you can see the immediately when the chick is fledged, you can see the their its mantle, their head, their breast, all of them are mottled. And by the end of the year, or maybe the when the chick completes the year, you can see it has all the male has already gotten the adult plumage, but at the same time you can see the amount of slight amount of brown on the wings, or even some parts of the head up here. And this is when the bird is in a proper adult breeding plumage, where it completely changes. But thankfully, as these changes last only for a year, it gets much easier to identify flycatchers. We really don't have to figure out the molt of the flycatchers in most of the cases. So what we should look out where when we go and look for flycatchers? First, I like to look at how the bird fits into entire habitat. Like if it's on the top of a tree, it's in the middle of a tree, it's on the bushes. And then I look at the size of the flycatcher. Is it a small size flycatcher? Like is it as small as taiga or let's say a red-breasted flycatcher? Is it a medium size flycatcher? Or it's a really large size flycatcher, like let's say large niltawa or even pale blue flycatcher or something like that. And then one more thing which I usually look out in the flycatcher is the stance of the bird. Is it a completely upright bird? Is it like slightly horizontal? And of course, as I mentioned earlier, I also look at the primary projection. So before we get to all these flycatchers, I want to start with this particular bird, because this is a flycatcher which we may get to see it maybe next a month or two. And I think some of these might be there by end of August as well. And spotted flycatchers fly through northwest of India only during these couple of, like during the month of August and September. And they're just passage migrant. But what I would like to point out right now over here is look at the stance of this bird has changed. Just because it's sitting on a thicker branch, the stance is kind of horizontal. And where it's sitting on a thinner branch, it's a much more upright bird. But this is one of the very few flycatchers which you may see in the field where a stance can be contrasting. That's why I wanted to keep this bird first. And also, let's say when you are looking for this bird, it's always whenever it passes through India, more or less it goes through northwest of India, which is much more or less low in elevation. But at the same time, you may go to Desert National Park, you may go to, let's say in Kutch or other parts of dry habitat. And in the entire vast habitat, you may find a tree or a bush. And in that tree or bush, you will find when there is at least one or two spotted flycatchers are present. And when they're present, you'll find like this in almost each and every bush which is around in this open habitat. And they're more or less easy to identify. They have mottled breast somewhat like that. And thankfully, when they pass through, there are no other flycatchers which we can confuse them with in that particular habitat. And they usually try and sit in the mid canopy and sometimes even the bushes. Then they don't really go and sit on top of a bush, but top of a tree. But this is what one should look out for. Where one should look out for. Then we go to another flycatcher called a dark-sided flycatcher. So if you have gone birding in the summer months in Himalayas, you'll always find this bird sitting right next to the roadside. Like there's a beautiful forest, there's an open road. If you bird inside a forest, you may not be able to see dark-sided flycatcher. But as soon as you are out on the road especially where the road cuttings, you'll definitely see a dark-sided flycatcher sitting there. And one of the main thing which you can see in this flycatcher is a very pale belly in the middle. Otherwise, more or less, it's a dark color bird. And they love to build nest on cliffs or road cuttings. And that's the reason why you'll always find this bird right next to the road, sitting on this kind of tree stump kind of habitat, other than inside a forest. So you can see them up to about 3,000 meters in Himalayas. Maybe about 2,000 meters upwards, and the habitat, the precise place where you should look out for this bird is the theme of this talk is like where to expect the bird, where which flycatcher, in what kind of habitat, rather than going and looking for oh, the bird has a pale bill or the lower mandible is there. Oh, those things are also important. No, there's no denying in that. But also that first you should eliminate most of the flycatchers, and then you come to the things where we should, where you have to look at the exact identification feature. So let's say if you are birding in two different places. So let's say if you are birding in winter, you may get to see Asian brown flycatcher, which is a very common flycatcher in South India. You can see the one with the dark legs. And what one should look out for, that two distinct populations of this bird. Now, always in the bushes or in trees, but more than that, the one on the left is actually a resident population of Asian brown flycatcher from Western Ghats. That very tiny populations of these birds in Western Ghats which are resident, but otherwise, more or less the Asian brown flycatchers turns up in the winter months across South India and Peninsular India, and they can be found very easily. They can be found all the way up to mountain tops in Western Ghats, all the way from plains. And then we come to this flycatcher called as brown-breasted flycatcher, a very dull brown color bird, which just looks like the other flycatchers which I showed earlier. But also look out for the pale color legs. So that's the only flycatcher in Massicapa genus where you'll see pale color legs. And it also has a very heavy headed structure. So when you look at it, it always appears like the head is very, very big compared to the body. And you can see them in mid canopy mainly. Even sometimes in bushes, sometimes quite a few times you will see them next to the streams, sitting quietly and hawking insects. You come to the next flycatcher, it's called a ferruginous flycatcher. It's a very funny bird. It's in the month of summer, and that too, like, this is like not somewhere where it's published, but once, I think 2008, I guess, when Trevor, me and a few guys, and we met in Eagle Nest, and we thought, let's study some flycatchers and we should be able to write some paper about it. And the idea was to see, so what we thought, that we will try and observe these birds, where do they sit on a tree, how far they go to catch insect. And when we see that they have captured a prey, can we see the prey which is there in their bill? And that actually gave us a good idea about how these birds feed. And I will be using some of those things. Ferruginous flycatchers turn up in Northeast only in the summer months. And they are found mainly in mid elevation, about 1500 meters to 2600 meters. And you'll always see them sitting on the lower part of the trees or just around the bushes. And they try and hawk insects maybe by going about 4 or 5 feet. Like, let's say compared to something like, for example, sooty flycatcher, which is also called as dark-sided flycatcher. They really go long distances to catch their prey. So all these minute things also can help you identify some of the flycatchers. Then we come to rusty-tailed flycatcher, which is actually a bird which is quite regularly seen in southern Western Ghats. And the main ID feature is the very bright rufous color tail, where in otherwise very dull brown color bird. Again, a bird which breeds in Western Himalayas, especially Kashmir and other areas, where it can go and breed up to about 2,500 meters. And one important thing about this bird is it always occupies slightly mid-canopy and bushes. But at the same time, its breeding habitat is right now getting threatened because of a lot of overgrazing in Western Himalayas. So that way, you may not really see this bird hawking after insects along for a lot of time. It just sits at one place and tries and catch the insects. Very rarely it goes after. It's not a very active hunter compared to other flycatchers. Then we come to one of my favorite birds, white gorgeted flycatcher. And it's a bird which is found in undergrowth mainly. You don't really go and see them in the on treetops. But This bird is extremely shy, very difficult to see. I remember first time when I saw this bird, it took me about, 40, 45 minutes just to see the bird, because we had no idea what that bird was. Because 2004, there were no recordings of any of these birds. And it was one of the first flycatchers which I got to see in Eagle Nest, which was a lot of fun. And here you can see the bird on the left is slightly paler in color compared to the bird on the right. That is mainly because it's a two different distinct populations of this bird in Northeast. One is north of the river Brahmaputra, one is south of the river Brahmaputra. But both of them, when it comes to behavior, both of them are very shy. You rarely get to see them. And always in the undergrowth. One more thing which you can say that like they are always found in a dense forest undergrowth. So there are lots of flycatchers you may find which are there in undergrowth in the same elevation, in the same overall habitat or overall area. But these ones will prefer a dense evergreen undergrowth compared to other flycatchers. Then in the same kind of place, you will always come across, or same mountain range, you will come across, let's say, pale blue flycatcher, which winters all the way to 100 meters in elevation. But when it comes to breeding, it goes up to 2000 meters. And they are mainly the mid to high canopy birds. They have a very distinct song. The females can be drab brown in color, but that's one of the largest flycatchers you will see in Northeast India, and relatively much easier to identify. You always get to see them, hear them rather than you see them, because they're vocal almost throughout the day, especially in the mornings and evenings. But once you know where to look for them, is like always in mid to high canopy, and that's what will help you out looking for them. Then we come back to Western Guards. These are classic, very slow moving flycatcher. The white-billed blue flycatcher, compared to other flycatchers, moves very slowly, goes after the insects also at a very slow manner, very lethargic in nature. And thankfully, the only bird which may look similar to that is the blue and white flycatcher, which may winter, like which is kind of rare bird that way in Western Ghats. But still, that one bird which may look similar to this bird. But always look out for this typical breast to belly pattern. And that's where you will see the difference between white-billed blue flycatcher and blue and white flycatcher. Blue and white flycatcher usually has a very clear-cut demarcation between the breast and the belly. And the bill is also very thick. The females have a very distinct, nice orange breast and pale chin. Again, a bird which is found between up to 800 meters in elevation. Above that is a bit rare. Always in the undergrowth. And sometimes it goes up to in the lower parts of the tree as well. And similarly to blue and white flycatcher, the bird which is there in Northeast India is white-tailed flycatcher. Extremely difficult bird to find. Mainly found south of the river Brahmaputra. Very distinct, very fat bill. Also, this bird is, again, the nesting of this bird has been a bit of a mystery in past, where no one really knows where to go, where to look for the, like, I think there, we don't know, no one even knows the clutch size of this bird. And there are some contrasting evidences in terms of in the literature, where they do they breed on a trees or on a road cutting. But again, a bird which is very lethargic, again found just like white-billed blue flycatcher, found in middle of the tree, up to about 1000 meters, 900 meters in elevation. And females usually show this very dark head and a nice white line along the throat. The white in the tail is a little bit difficult to observe most of the time. And if one is birding near Dhing Patkai or even in, let's say, places like Mizoram, Nagaland, or even Namdafa is one of the best places to see this bird. Again, it's not a very easy bird to see unless and until you know what you're looking for. And the song is important ID pointer or where to look for this bird again. Then we come to another lowland evergreen forest bird of Northeast India and Central Himalayas, and a bit of a Eastern Ghats as well. There is some population is there in Odisha, which actually shows a lot more bluish tinge on the back. And there's a hypothesis that these birds can be are probably integrating with Tickle's blue flycatcher in Eastern Ghats. And again, where the male and female looks very similar, which is not the case in quite a few of these Cyornis flycatchers, where the males are more beautiful than the females. This is one of the exceptional cases where both male or female looks almost similar to each other. Again, found in the lower part of the tree to mid part of the tree. Very typical distinct song, just like a Tickle's blue flycatcher kind of call, and the song ends with a very typical Cyornis flycatcher, where it ends with a very sharp note. Again, a bird which is, if you are birding in Nameri, Kaziranga, anywhere in lowland Assam, where in the evergreen forest, this bird is very easily seen. You can see them up to about 700 meters in elevation, but typical lowland evergreen forest bird. Then we come to slightly difficult flycatchers in our lives in terms of identification. So this is a hill blue flycatcher. One of the things which you will notice from the other Cyornis flycatcher in Northeast India while birding is you should always look out for the leg color of the birds. So hill blue flycatcher and large bill blue flycatcher are the only two flycatchers which have a pale color legs. But when you look at a large blue flycatcher, which is there in the inset here, it always has much thicker and broader bill, and which bird also has a very distinct, slow, mournful song compared to hill blue flycatcher. Both of them can be found in a similar elevation, let's say about up to 1,000 meters, 1,600 meters in certain cases. But hill blue flycatcher usually prefers habitat like a bamboo. And you'll always find them in undergrowth like this, and dense undergrowth. Like let's say if you are birding in around 600, 700 meters in Mishmi Hills, and let's say if you go up, let's say if you are birding around a hill tourism camp, then hill blue flycatcher is one of your first birds you will get to hear and see in that area. Also, one thing you need to look out for while separating them from large blue flycatcher or large bill blue flycatcher is you should look out for the primary projection. The primary projection in hill blue flycatcher is medium in length, and in the large blue flycatcher, which is like this, is much, much, much longer. You can see the much longer primary projection over here. And of course, the large thick bill. So the best way to do that, and of course, they always show pale legs, but very contrasting face to chest rufous color. And this is something which stands out when you look out for large bill blue flycatcher or large blue flycatcher. They are again found in the undergrowth and lower part of the tree. But also, they go slightly more higher up in elevation compared to hill blue flycatcher. So hill blue flycatcher might be more common around 700, 800 meters in elevation. These birds are slightly higher up than that. They can be found in bamboo as well, but mainly you can see them in a dense undergrowth. Then we come to blue-throated blue flycatcher, a bird which has actually given, even though it's a very common bird, Himalayas as well as in South India in winter, it always fascinated me for many different reasons. So for example, there is a male on the left, and this is a male of one subspecies or whatever, what we think as subspecies, with a very distinct blue throat. But look at the other two individuals on the right. And if you are birding in Northeast India, you'll always find maybe about 70 to 80% of the birds, they have this rufous going all the way up on their throat. And the blue color present only at the base of the bill and the lower part of their upper part of their throat. So which has made life a little more difficult? Are there two distinct species? So I think Trevor Price, Pratap Singh, Paul Alstrom, they tried to look out for some sequences in these birds. And as of now, we still really don't know. Funny thing is they don't really respond to only their songs. They respond to almost each and other flycatcher song. And in fact, you can see in this photo where the female is also singing, not just male. So this particular bird in which even the females have been known to sing, and which makes life a little bit more difficult. But if you want to look out for this bird, then always look out for this kind of blue, which is always present. Let's say if you're birding in South India, I just hope we are not overlooking some of these birds, Vorticus blue flycatchers with orange throats. But yeah, there is a lot to learn in blue-throated flycatcher complex. And maybe in coming years, we'll know a lot more. They're always found up to about 1,000 meters in 1,200 meters in elevation. They prefer slightly degraded habitat as well, not just like dense habitat. They're found in the undergrowth as well as lower part of the tree. And hopefully we'll know more about these birds in future. And then we come to Tickle's blue flycatcher. Then Tickle's one of our most common regular birds, which you can see in peninsular India. Very distinct. See, the throat is not really blue, it's just orange. This is a male on the right and female on the left. Females do have blue in them, but much, much drabber in color. This female had actually nested in on our electricity box in Bangalore a few years back. And you can see them up to about 1,000 meters in elevation, all the way from 0 meters. They are always found in undergrowth or in mid canopy. And one of the last birds to sing, even all, just like other flycatchers, they sing almost when it's like pitch dark. Then we come to one of the most range restricted species of flycatchers in the country. So as of now, Nicobar jungle flycatcher is known only from two islands, Little Nicobar and Great Nicobar. Again, it was very funny when Vishnu and I saw this bird in 2015. We were looking for this bird. And while going through a stream, all of a sudden Vishnu stopped and asked me, oh, is this a Sirenis flycatcher? And that time it was not placed in Sirenis genus, but she was absolutely right, because after a few years, it was indeed placed in Sirenis flycatchers now. So earlier it was in brown-breasted jungle flycatcher group. And now it's moved to, all those birds are now moved to Sirenis. Again, a bird which I've seen only singly or in pairs. One more thing which I was not very sure about first couple of times when I saw it, but when I went there a couple more times, I realized that they are more or less next to the streams where one can find them. Again, a very beautiful song, but dull brown in color. Male, female look similar to each other. Before we saw the bird, there was one sighting from, Little Nicobars, AP Zabin sighting. And before that, it was sighted in 1977 by Abdul Ali. And before that, it was in 1903, literally. So this bird was kind of missing in between, but we know that it's found mainly in undergrowth or again, lower parts of the tree, like just like other Sirenis flycatchers. But as of now, we know they are found only in the lowlands. I don't know if they are found in the high elevations of Nicobar, islands, but could be, because no one has really gone and looked for them at higher up in mountains. Then we come to slightly bright looking birds called Niltawas. So large Niltawa, as name says, it's very large in size. You get to see them in the mid canopy to lower parts of the trees. I see them about 2,000 meters, 2,200 meters in elevation, but they do winter all the way to lower elevations as well. If you are birding in Nameri, you can see them. If you're birding at Bumpu, you can see them, but that changes depending on the season. One thing which, like, sometimes a lot of time you get to see just the photos of the bird, and if you want to identify them, you can always look out for the forehead of this bird. The forehead of large Niltawa is almost flattish compared to, let's say, birds like small Niltawa, which usually has much more rounded head. They are much smaller in size. Again, this is an example where male and female both are singing. Again, a bird which moves up and down in elevation, goes all the way to 0 meters. And when they breed all the way to 2,600 meters, much, much higher up than when small, large Niltawas as well. So when you look at these birds, you'll always, I'll come to the slide where I will explain why I'm putting elevations and the habitat of these birds right next to each other. But this is something which is very important when it comes to flycatcher identification point of view. Then we come to Rufus billed Niltawa, another bird which among the Niltawas shows a little bit tiny bit of white on the throat. Males are very distinct with a distinct rufous belly which goes all the way up. Sometimes people mistake them with vivid Niltawa, which is not very common that way, or we don't know yet. Again, a bird which is there in the top of the lower part of the tree to mid canopy, goes all the way to 2000 meters to when it breeds, winters all the way to 100 meters, again, just like other Niltawas. And then you come to vivid Niltawa. So let's go back once. So when you look at these two flycatchers, I always feel vivid Niltawa is much more slender. It has much more flatter head compared to rufous billed Niltawa. And again, the song is very distinct. I think, again, a bird which winters in South Assam Hills, Southeast Asia. There is one population, a different subspecies present all the way in Taiwan. I really don't know where to expect in the lower elevation, but it's been known. I've seen them in around 2,000, 2,200 meters in elevation in Western Arunachal Pradesh as well as in Mishmi Hills. Again, a bird which is found in slightly higher up in the canopy compared to Rufus billed Niltawa. And then we come to blue and white flycatcher. Again, a bird which has been showing up in last few years in India very regularly. So I don't want to call it as a vagrant now because it's been seen a few times now. Again, the bird on top one is the subadult bird where it's blue and gray in color. But bottom two are actually two distinct species. The one on the left is a Zepis flycatcher. The one on the right is a blue and white flycatcher, which may look like a white-billed blue flycatcher. And one of the things which you should look out for is because I'm sure both these birds winter in Andaman and Nicobars. They are just overlooked. What you should look out for is the actual breast color, because in blue and white flycatcher males, the throat and breast itself is a lot more darker along with the ear coverts. In Zepis flycatcher, it's more or less blue with a black present only on the demarcation of the belly and the breast. But here it's impossible to see that black line because the entire breast is itself has a blackish tinge. The females of these birds look, both species look very similar to each other. It's almost impossible to tell them apart. I think there is one key where people look out for the white at the base of the tail, but I would still say there's a lot more information is required to tell them apart. Again, a bird which is, I'm sure, much more regular in India than we actually think of. Again, found in the bushes or again, low part of the tree. No one really knows about elevation. And then you come to world eater flycatcher, a bird from Himalayas as well as in peninsular India, long distance migrant. The male world eater is actually because of its color. And the females are equally pretty. They don't really have this kind of very dark lowers and but they are slightly greenish in color compared to the males. Very easy bird to see, found up to about 3000 meters in elevation in him when they breed or when they winter there, they can be in plains. But they're always found in mid to high canopy, sitting on top of a tree or top of a wire. Again, a bird which goes after long distances long sallies when they go and catch insects. Again, a bird which the reason why it sits on top of a tree or in the open branches because again, where they breed, because most of them breed on the road cuttings. So where the flycatchers breed, accordingly, they actually try and occupy the trees or bushes or branches. Then we come to another beautiful bird, Nilgiri flycatcher, found in Western Ghats, that too, a Shola forest of Western Ghats. You can see them up about 1,000 meters and upwards, all the way to the highermost Sholas. A male which are slightly more colorful than females. If you are birding in, so just like 2 days ago, I saw one in Valparai, but you just have to drive towards slightly higher up in mountains than the city. But as soon as you go about 1,000 meters, the chances of seeing Nilgiri flycatcher goes up. Again, a bird which is found higher up in the tree and top of a tree to mid canopy, rarely descends down to bushes, but you can see them in bushes as well. Then you come to the slaty-backed flycatcher. Again, a very distinct bird where male and female look completely different. A lot of time you'll find slaty-backed flycatchers sharing the habitat with slaty blue flycatcher, which will come to the next bird. But when you look out for this bird, you've seen them up to about 2,000 meters in elevation. The males are very easy because they are almost three-colored, with the lower part of the belly is white, with a distinct contrast between the head and breast and throat. But the females are much, much, much darker compared to slaty blue flycatcher. Slaty blue flycatcher, when you see it, you will see them very pale in color. But slaty back flycatcher are much darker in color. They do show this rufous tinge on the tail as well, found all the way up to 2000 meters, mainly in undergrowth flycatcher. Undergrowth of a dense forest is even more preferred by these flycatchers than the other ones. And then there is a rufous gorgeted flycatcher, again a bird of undergrowth. But if you look at this bird, you'll always find them in a degraded habitat compared to slaty blue flycatcher or slaty back flycatcher as well. They are found up to about 3000 meters, one of the highermost elevational flycatchers you will see in the country. They do go down to 100 meters in winter. So they do show, again, typical elevational movement of these birds. And the classic undergrowth bird of, if you're birding in Himalayas, then this is one of the familiar sight for any bird watcher. There's a red-breasted flycatcher. So red-breasted flycatcher and red-throated flycatcher were considered as one species. A lot of people usually struggle, but one of the best ways to look for them is look for the upper tail coverts. So when you look at this part of red-breasted flycatcher, is always pale, along with the pale base of the bill. And if you see these two characteristics, then there is no need to worry about identification of this bird. They're again found in the bushes or even the lower parts of the trees as well. Then we come to taiga flycatcher, which was earlier clubbed with red-breasted flycatcher. Again, a bird where you can see the upper tail coverts, which are completely dark. The lower base mandible is also very dark here. The red is restricted only to the throat and not to the breast. Again, a bird of a complete and major undergrowth. What I've also noticed that they are a lot more common towards northeastern part as well. So where red-breasted flycatcher is slightly rarer in that case. But rest of the India, both of them can be seen together in lots of habitat. Just like most of the flycatchers, they can be very peculiar to their wintering habitat every year. They might come to the same area again and again. And again, found in bushes to lower habitat, lower part of the tree. Then you come to Kashmir flycatcher, a very, very, very restricted bird when it comes to breeding also, as well as wintering also. So where it breeds, it again breeds in Western Himalayas and Kashmir. And as the name suggests, they like to feed in undergrowth. Again, a bird which has been suffering because of overgrazing in Western Himalayas in last few years, a very distinct contrasting throat to breast and the black lines which comes down. The females can be a little tricky, but sometimes they can look similar to red-breasted flycatchers. But I always look out for the rufous, which goes onto the flanks or much, much lower part of the belly. And that's how I usually try and identify them. The lots of red-breasted flycatcher and Kashmir flycatcher juvenile may look similar to each other. So it's better to leave them alone rather than identifying them. But if you can see the orange going all the way to the belly, then there's a good chance of being Kashmir flycatcher than red-breasted flycatcher. Again, a bird which goes to 2000 meters when it comes to breeding as well as in wintering. Again, a very patchy distribution. There's a stronghold of this bird are around Ooty. Then there are for some weird reason, it's not so common or very rarely reported from other parts of Kerala. And again, it's very common wintering bird in parts of higher elevations of Sri Lanka. So if you're birding at 2000 meters in Sri Lanka, in any gardens also you can see them. Same thing goes with Ooty. So about 1000 to 2000 meters is the perfect elevation for this bird, found in undergrowth to the mid lower part of the trees, just like other redbreast and red-throated flycatchers. And then we come to some of the prettiest flycatchers. Snowy-browed flycatcher is one of those. You can always see a nice tinge of brown on the wings. Sometimes it does look like rusty-billed short wing. A lot of people have misidentified them in the field. Again, a bird with a very strong bill, bird of undergrowth, exclusively, I would say, in undergrowth, goes up to 2,500 meters when it breeds. Females do have this kind of slight kind of bluish to grayish tinge on the back, which is usually not so much present in other flycatchers, small size flycatcher, a very tiny flycatcher, found only in undergrowth again. And then we come to little firefly flycatcher. Again, a tiny flycatcher. Males are unmistakable black and white in color. The female can be a little tricky, but the best way I tell them apart is by, they almost always give you a feeling of a red start other than a flycatcher. They have a very contrasting back to belly coloration. Again, you will find in them in an elevation which is 2,000 meters where lots of other flycatchers are present. But the best to tell them apart is by looking for them in a degraded forest. So let's say if you are birding in Konoma, you will find them on the way towards the parking lot, but not in the forest above parking lot. Or with, let's say if you are birding in places like Mandala or places very degraded in nature rather than a dense evergreen forest. So little pirate flycatcher is always, they try and avoid dense forest compared to trashy forest. Then we come to ultramarine flycatcher, another pretty bird, winters all the way to South India. If you're birding in a dry habitat, you might find a couple of trees where this bird is wintering. A very pale looking bird, females are very pale looking underneath with the contrasting upper parts. Male can be variable. This is the first year bird where the head is still not blue, it still has some kind of brown in color, but there's a bluish tinge on the back and the tail. And when you look at the birds, like there's the ones on the left are actually from Himalayas. And the lowermost is from westernmost Himalayas. The middle one is from Eagle Nest and other areas. And topmost is from Wollong. And you can see the amount of white of supercilium which changes. Because there are three distinct subspecies which are present in the Himalayas. And according to these different subspecies, the amount of white on the in the brow can change, but you will always find these nice flanks or necklaces which are kind of broken at the middle of the breast. That's one of the main ID features of this bird. Again, a bird which is commonly middle elevations, but unlike other birds, they try and tend to be in middle part of the trees. Again, a very bold bird. They can be found next to human habitats as well as in dense forest as well. Then you come to slaty blue flycatcher. And again, the way I'm trying to show you this, because there are two distinct populations in this species. So the one on the left is South Assam Hill population. The one on the right is the Western Himalayan population. And they do have this white on the upper tail area. They show this, the South Assam Hill population shows a nice rufous belly compared to white belly of Western Himalayan or even north of the river Brahmaputra birds as well. The birds, the females are also a lot more paler compared to slaty back flycatcher. Again, a bird which is found up to 2000 meters, again, only in winters low, all the way to lower elevations, but the bird of always of the undergrowth. Slaty blue flycatcher will be, I would say, lot more bolder compared to slaty back flycatcher. Then you come to sapphire flycatcher, another very pretty bird, has kind of that kind of broken necklace kind of thing, but with always with a rufous throat, a tinier flycatcher compared to even ultramarine flycatcher. The male has a very distinct plumage in breeding and non-breeding. The non-breeding males develop this rufous color on the head. The wings still remain blue. The females do have a very tiny bit of throat color, which is very restrictive to the throat or just the upper parts of the breast. birds which breeds around 2,500 meters in elevation. Again, a bird which always you'll always find in a slightly degraded habitat, right next to the road. You'll find them on treetops. They and the higher up in the canopy rather than lower down. So you'll always looking up when you look for this bird. And again, a very distinct bird when it comes to identification. Then there are certain more vagrants in the country, like yellow-rump flycatcher. There have been few records from Kerala, one from Madhya Pradesh, I would say even, I think, Andaman Nicobars, I guess. So again, a very distinct bird, unmistakable bird. Even I would say if someone is birding in Andaman Nicobars, or even look out for this bird in around mangrove or mangrove associate plant habitat as well. They do love such kind of habitat. Very common bird in Southeast Asia. So it should be regular bird in Andaman and Nicobars. Again, the bird which is mainly found in undergrowth. Then Mugi Maki flycatcher is another bird which has been reported in the last few years from Andaman and Nicobars. Andaman mainly, but should be there in Nicobars as well. Again, a bird, classic of undergrowth. A very common bird in Southeast Asia. There it goes and it winters in mid elevations as well. So a very distinct looking bird with a slightly distinct broken eyebrow behind the eye, a very distinct pattern on the wing. Again, a bird which is found in the lower part of the tree or even undergrowth. Then you come to pygmy flycatchers, our tiniest possible flycatcher. It's like as small as a flower picker, a very tiny bird. Loves to be in mid elevations to highly higher up elevations, about 2,800 meters. Winters all the way to 100 meters in lower down in Assam. Winters like it prefers under bushes and in the lower canopy of a tree. A very tiny flycatcher. Often the best way to look for them is by fishing, and they respond really well to fishing, and they are very common in and around mid elevation forest. They love forest, slightly denser forest as well as degraded both. So again, now we come to a flycatcher, the black and orange flycatcher. Just like Nilgiri flycatcher, this is a bird which loves sholas, but Nilgiri flycatcher occupies higher up part of the trees, where black and orange flycatchers loves to occupy undergrowth. So they're always found about 1400 meters and above, all the way to the Shola forest of Western Ghats. They're exclusively found there. A very pretty looking bird found in undergrowth as well, like mainly in undergrowth. And now what I was taught by telling you all these elevations and let's say the habitat is by looking at, there are so many flycatchers I spoke about. I've chosen a few over here. And now you can see how these flycatchers are trying to separate themselves or different niches in the same elevational or maybe in the same in a single mountain range. So dark side flycatcher, as I told you earlier, will always prefer top of a tree, slightly higher up in elevation. Then there will be white gorget flycatcher around the same elevation, but always in the undergrowth. Then there is pale blue flycatcher, which is found around 1,200 or 800 meters in elevation, but at the same time, it always prefers top of a tree. Then there is pale chin blue flycatcher, which prefers a lowermost elevation, but again, found in the area, the part found in the lower part of the tree. Little pied flycatcher found in the same area as white gorget flycatcher, but they prefer a degraded habitat and above, and of course, in the upper canopy. Then there is a blue-throated blue flycatcher, which is found in the lower part of the tree, but at the same time, they always prefer something like under parts of the tree, but they are always found in the lowermost elevation. Then there is white flycatcher, which again found in the highermost elevations, but they always try and sit on top of a tree or on open areas. Snowy-browed flycatcher will be in dense forest in undergrowth. At the same time, they will be in the middle elevation, just like white-gorget flycatcher, or maybe in the same similar elevations. So all these flycatchers try and separate themselves by using a very distinct habitats and very distinct part of the elevations as well. So that's how, if you know, if you start putting flycatchers along with the elevational ranges and habitat, then it becomes much, much easier to identify them in the field rather than trying to see the lower mandible colors or the primary projections or the tail is cocked up or the what is a posture. But once you start putting these birds together with the elevational ranges with habitat, life becomes much simpler. And then there are other birds which are not Massicapidae, and we earlier thought they were flycatchers. We still call them flycatchers, but they so these are the three Massicapidae. These are the three fantails which are found in peninsular India as well as Himalayas, white-throated, white-browed, and white-spotted fantail. All of them are very distinct, easy to identify. They are very. They are always moving from branch to branch, very active birds. And then there is monarchs also, which earlier thought to be a flycatchers. India has about, I think, two or three subspecies. A widespread bird. Males look very way more prettier than the female, where they show this blue head with a belly, and then there's a nice black necklace. Females have blue color, but they have a very drab looking back. Again, a bird which is very common across India, found in up to middle elevations, mainly in the undergrowth and even the trees. And then we come to paradise flycatchers. Again, they are say relatives of monarchs, but I have actually showing you three species here, the three species of females and two species of males. And the one on the left is a Blythe's paradise flycatcher, which has slightly blunter crest compared to Indian paradise flycatcher, which has a very distinct crest, a very thin, long crest. And when you look at it, it's much, then it becomes much easier. The tail also, I always find Indian paradise flycatcher has a much longer tail, but that can be variable depending on which population you're looking at. The one on the right middle here is Amur paradise flycatcher female. They do have a very distinct maroon color on the mantle. On the other hand, the Blythe's paradise flycatcher does not have that kind of maroon color over here. Amur paradise males usually show they are much, much more whiter than the Blythe's paradise flycatcher. They tend to show less amount of black on the wings as well as on the tail shafts. Again, I'm sure the bird which is should be a lot more regular in Andaman and Nicobars than we actually think of. And I'm sure one of these days we'll even find a Japanese paradise flycatcher over there. And then we come to graded canary flycatchers. So another family which of birds which has graded canary flycatcher and yellow-billed fantails. And I've used two distinct photos here. If you may notice, the bird on the right is slightly more darker in color compared to the one on the left. And the one on the left is the bird which breeds in Himalayas but winters also in South India. The one on the right is actually a endemic population or subspecies of Ceylonensis, which is found in Western Ghats, Southern Western Ghats. And that's like they're a lot more darker compared to the Himalayan birds. Again, a bird which is found in middle elevations, very common bird, a familiar song or call while birding in Himalayas as well as in Western Ghats, always found in the mid canopy to high canopy. And then we come to yellow-billed fantail, again a bird in Himalayas and South Assam hills, very distinct tiny bird, which is not related to even our typical fly fantails as well found in the country. So again, a very distinct looking bird. And that's it, I guess. With that, I would like to end this presentation. I would like to thank Nick, Kavi, Anita, Delhi Bird, Vishnu with some kind of inputs on the presentation, and lots of photographers who contributed for the presentation. Thank you, guys.
Thanks, Shashank. That was really, really fantastic. And we loved your taking
I
us through
just
the journey
hope
of
people could hear
flycatcher.
me here and there, but
Yes, and we have opened the chat now for anybody who has any questions for Shashank. We've
okay.
opened the chat now.
Just post your questions on the chat box and we'll take them up from there. So while we wait for questions to come in. Shashank, I have a question.
Okay. Yes.
You know, when we see flycatchers in Delhi, especially migrants, we typically see them sometimes in pairs, sometimes alone. So what is the pattern? Do flycatchers migrate in pairs, or do they, do females and males migrate separately? Is there any pattern to this?
Interesting questions. I think there are lots of places, because flycatchers are also, they tend to winter in the same area again and again every year. And they also like to, I think there are examples of certain Phylloscopus warblers, where the male and female do winter separately.
Okay.
And they also try and that's what might maybe happening in around your area as well, where they might be just males going through certain areas only females are going through. We really don't know. There are like so many things which we don't know about, even the commonest possible flycatchers. So that could be one of the possibilities why I would say there is like certain bird we are looking at the same female red-throated flycatcher. Again and again in the same area. So they might be migrating separately or maybe together.
Okay. So
Anita, while we get the questions coming in, we can just go through the announcements and the question of the day that Shashank has for the viewers.
I'm unable to put my screen full screen for some reason.
Let me try to share, Shashank. That should help. Just give me 1 second.
No, I can't see the screen right now. That's the problem.
Oh, you can't see, your screen seems to be stuck, right?
Yeah, it's back up. Okay.
Okay, perfect. So just an announcement for all our viewers. One of our partners for these talks is Sanctuary Nature Foundation. And as part of this, Sanctuary is offering a 1-year free digital subscription to all the viewers of the Delhi Bird Talks. So in order to get your free subscription, you can just go to www.delhibirdfoundation.org/offers. Given your email address and details, and you will receive your free digital subscription. You can subscribe to either Sanctuary Asia magazine or the Sanctuary Asia Cub magazine, which is for kids. Moving on, we have another talk lined up tomorrow. It's called Champions of the Flyway, which is going to be hosted by Jonathan. So this is about an event that takes place in Israel every year to protect birds flying through the migratory corridor over there. So Jonathan will take us through what the event is about, what kind of birds do you see, and how that event raises funds for conserving the flyway and for conserving birds in that migratory route. So this is again at 5 p.m. tomorrow using the same Zoom meeting ID. So hopefully we'll see all of you there tomorrow as well. The third announcement is one of our primary sponsors for these talks is again Zayas. And as part of this, every talk, the speaker asks a question of the day to the viewers. The person who gives the correct answer, one person will be selected and they'll get an opportunity to win either a Zayas binocular harness or a Zayas cleaning kit. Do not give the answers in the Zoom chat box. Please submit your answers to www.delhibirdfoundation.org/contest. Shashank, do you want to ask our viewers the question for today?
So the question is, there is a flycatcher found in India, which is named after a biologist's friend and a cook. Name the bird as well as the biologist who described it.
Great. So basically two things you need to give them, not just the name of the bird, but also the name of the biologist.
Yes.
The correct answer, one person gets to win this prize. If you'd like, you can take a photograph of this screen. We will also be putting this question up on the Delhi Bird Foundation Facebook page. There's a new page that we've created for updates. So I will share the link of that page on the Zoom chat. It'd be great if all of you can follow that page and stay updated with the latest talks that are going to take place. With that, I'll hand it over to Anita to take forward the question and answer session.
Okay. Thanks, Kavi. There's an interesting question here from Alpa. What she's asking is, have you seen changes in flycatcher behavior and population in the past decade due to playback or environmental degradation? Are you seeing any patterns?
I haven't really seen any changes because of the playback as of now. But there could be, because the flycatchers directly depend on insects, right?
Right.
So insects are taking toll like everywhere, like from Himalayas to Western Ghats. And that's something which we may have to be like really careful of, because that will directly affect the birds which are there in like birds like flycatchers will directly get affected because of drop in numbers, or even let's say, for example, arrival of these flycatchers and arrival of insects can also be, there have been studies in Europe which have shown that the insects are emerging much earlier compared to the bird's arrival. So the bird nesting has been unsuccessful in the last few years. So there could be many reasons because of why these flycatchers may get affected because of insect numbers directly.
Right. Okay. A different kind of question. This is from Umesh, and what he's asking is, are the, and I think a lot of us have the same question, are the Amur and Blight's paradise flycatchers seen regularly in India? And if so, where do you go look for them?
So Blight's paradise flycatcher is actually very common in Northeast India. So all paradise flycatcher, which Bird Book shows in Northeast India as Indian paradise flycatchers, are actually Blight's paradise flycatchers. So there could be, there should be a range where somewhere in Northeast, somewhere in West, somewhere East of West Bengal, there is a shift which happens where the Indian paradise flycatcher stops. So the, even the image which I showed you was from Eagle Nest, and across Northeast India, you get do get to see Blight's paradise flycatcher. Extremely common in up to about 700, 750 meters in elevation. Always look out for the crest. And Andaman and Nicobar should have Amur as well as Blight's paradise flycatcher wintering. And there is one resident population in Nicobars as well of Blight's paradise flycatcher. So both birds should be there. So the best way to tell them apart is by looking at their mantle color in females, and in the males, one should look out for the Amur will be a lot more whiter, plenty of white in it compared to even much more whiter than the male Blight's paradise flycatcher.
Right.
So Blight's paradise flycatcher, to be in short, like if you want to see Blight's paradise flycatcher, Northeast India is the best bet.
Got it. Okay. So there's another question here about flycatcher migration, which is from Soma. And what she's asking is, typically from which geographies do these migrating flycatchers come in addition to Siberia? Do they come from a very diverse range of geographies, or is it all from on the main flyway?
So I would say there are lots of red-breasted and red-throated flycatchers. They are coming in like a funnel in India. But at the same time, lots of flycatchers are using, so the let's say brown-breasted flycatcher, which winters in Western Ghats and Sri Lanka, goes northeast in direction and crosses northeast via Eastern Ghats. So they pass through Eastern Ghats, cross northeast India. So sometimes you do get to see them in Eastern Ghats on passage. You do get to see them in northeast in passage, and then they go to south. I think probably in South China where they breed. So there are flycatchers. Then there are flycatchers which actually breed in Himalayas, and then they just come down. Like for example, what I would say that the blue-throated blue flycatcher population which we get to see in Western Ghats is has lot more blue throat than the orange throat. So I don't recollect seeing the orange throat blue-throated blue flycatcher in Western Ghats. So that might be just a Western Himalayan population coming straight down, possibly, but I don't know that for sure. And then the blue-throated blue population in Northeast India may just remain there. They may not even migrate. So there might be some local migration. Some of them are long distance migration. So there are all the flycatchers, they move around depending on which area or the elevation, depending on where the geographical area as well. There's a lot of variation in that.
Right. So obviously there's a lot of different kinds of cross flights that are essentially happening, right? It's not, there's no pattern.
Yes, some of them are just coming from northeast to south, like northeast and northwest towards India. Some of them are actually going this northeast and southwest diagonal migration. Some of them are just coming straight north to south migration. So So yeah, lot to know.
It's clearly a lot of movement. Okay, now, another interesting question from Sushmita. I think she's asking really about why a lot of the flycatchers we saw on the presentation today had blue plumages. Is there some reason for this? I mean, there was...
Okay, so...
It makes it also very confusing to identify these flycatchers. So what's
it... It's one of my favorite questions, actually, like the favorite topics. So we don't really know why these birds do have a lot of blue. Hopefully sometime in future, we may be able to separate out a gene which is responsible for this particular color in the bird. So maybe there might be rufous and blue color combination, which is getting selected a lot more in flycatchers for some certain amount, certain kind of gene other than anything else. And that might be related to habitat, but more or less it could be just because of the species. Like for example, like all the cyanus flycatchers have blue color. And that could be just because of that. It's some gene is responsible for that color other than anything else.
Right. And in the same vein, mm-hmm. There's another question from Deepak who's really asking, why do a lot of flycatchers tend to have very large eyes, you know, as a proportion of their face size?
Yes.
So what's the reason for that?
There are two things which flycatchers have very in distinctness. You can see in the flycatcher is a large eyes because they can see the prey well, and they always have very long bristles. But their bristles are sometimes as long as their bill tip. So that also helps them catch insects. So that's the reason why they have very large eyes.
All right. Okay. And another question here from Kavi. In terms of what flycatchers are not currently recorded in India that you feel might get added to the Indian list in the near future? Like which flycatchers should we be looking for?
There are lots of these Masikaba flycatchers, brown streak flycatcher from Southeast Asia. There is the Zepis flycatcher should be there. So there are these typical Southeast Asian flycatchers, which might be Amur Paradise flycatcher is anyway now recorded. I would say even Japanese Paradise flycatcher might be there in Andaman Nicobar. So these are the typical bird flycatchers which I would expect to be there, which I'm sure they are there, but we haven't seen them yet, some of them.
Right. And a question about flycatcher diets. I mean, do they essentially eat only insects? There's a question here from Sri who's asking whether flycatcher diet includes butterflies, which are, of course, a kind of insect, but does it also include
large? They do eat butterflies as well sometimes.
Is there anything for the diversity in their diet?
So what I have noticed is that it depends on where the birds usually perch. Like, so the diet changes because of their perching habits or where they are located on a tree. The insects which flies much higher up in the canopy are taken away by, let's say, sooty flycatcher which is a dark-sided flycatchers or verdure flycatchers. They go after slightly bigger insects compared to, let's say, the birds from undergrowth, but I could be wrong. But this is like something which I noticed. Like the diet varies a lot depending on where the bird perches, rather than. Yeah, that's something which I've noticed. I don't know if how true it is.
Yeah, there's no conclusive answer to that yet. Mm-hmm. Another question again to do with plumage. Arnab has this question: why is there a difference in the same flycatcher species shows a difference in color patterns in different areas of the Himalayas from the eastern to the western range? There is a stark change in plumage sometimes. And of course, we've seen that in other species as well. But correct. I guess the question here is really about flycatchers.
Okay, so that could be because of their distinct populations, which are breeding in the certain areas. And that's the reason why those populations have, over the years, have thousands of years, have changed the colors. Like, for example, as we know, not just for flycatchers, but most of the species which are found in Himalayas, they have colonized Himalayas from east to west. So you'll always find the western population of these birds are a lot more, let's say, that the western populations are subset of the populations of east. And that's why the colorations have also, depending on the populations, have changed. So maybe if that answers the question.
I think it does. In the sense that you're saying that because of as they move further outward, they evolved in some
they
way.
They evolved. So basically, the populations have gone colonizing from east to west, and now they are distinct populations. Like the central Himalayan populations are separate. The western Himalayan are separate. The eastern Himalayan are separate. South Assam hills are separate. And because of that itself, like for example, there was a difference in white gorget flycatcher in north and south of the river as well, right? The south one was much more darker compared to north one, and two distinct populations and subspecies, which really don't really, they don't really cross the Brahmaputra river. And that's the reason why they were two distinct populations there.
Right. And I guess that's where speciation also really starts. It's a starting
correct.
Point.
That's the first step.
Yeah. Right.
Isolation.
So I think some very good questions there. And I think and a brilliant talk as usual in terms of what to look for when we go looking for flycatchers. So I think we'd all be hopefully be wiser and smarter when we head out to see flycatchers on our next birding trips. And I think it's time to say goodbye. I think
one second, someone wanted my email address. I'm gonna type it over there.
Put it on the box, yeah.
Yeah, I'm just gonna type it over there. So one sec, it has should go to everyone in the meeting, and here you go.
It's there? Okay. So anybody, any further questions, you can address them to Shashank. His email is in the chat box. And I think we're going to leave you finally with this image of the talk to look forward to tomorrow.
Yes,
so
I'm looking forward for his talk tomorrow.
For Israel. Yeah. All right. Awesome. Thanks, everyone. Thanks for joining.
Thank you, guys. I hope you guys are able to hear me here and there. But let's see how it went. I don't know.